Hey, Grace Church, it's Pastor James here just to say that while we can't be together in person, it's good to have the means and the ability to worship together in a spirit no matter where we're at. So if you would just like it, subscribe, and drop us a comment, just let us know that you were here, and join us as we worship together.
We can praise Him in the midst of storms all because of who He is, amen? He's got our lives in the palm of His hand. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My
thank you. Grace family, as you take this time to use our online giving options for tithes and offerings, please allow me to tell you about a few other things happening around our church. Unfortunately, the first thing I need to tell you is that we are postponing some youth events that we have scheduled in the next 2 weeks. But please know they are truly postponed, not canceled. I know other students will agree that over the last year there have been too many canceled events, but these are still going to happen. Our Mid-South Mission Area event is moving to After Momentum, temporarily scheduled for March 6th. The New Year's Christmas party will be happening at the end of the month. And Wednesday Night Youth Group will temporarily move back online for just the next 2 weeks of 2021. These events and things like Momentum and Dodgeball are coming really soon, so enjoy the holiday and we know we will all be together soon. Now, here's James to share some information for the children of our church and their parents.
Hey, so 4th, 5th, and 6th graders, this announcement is just for you. Nazatween is right around the corner. We're still planning on doing it January 23rd. So mark your calendars again for January 23rd. That's all 4th, 5th, and 6th graders. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please talk to me and I'll get you all that information that I have.
As we start the new year, we are also starting a new opportunity for everyone connected to our Church Together for Prayer online. Starting January 5th, we will be posting a guided prayer and short devotional video weekly that you can watch together as it premieres. And if you aren't able to watch it then, you can make time for it as your schedule allows. It will be there waiting for you. This is just a way for more of us to make lifting each other up in prayer and growing deeper in our faith together a part of our week. So we hope you will check it out. Keep checking your texting services, Breeze, and social media to stay up to date on what's happening around our church. You'll see what I've already talked about, as well as some other things like these. In this time, when we take in this service with many miles between some of us, I am glad that church is an event or a building. It's the movement of God and His people in the world. We are the family of God, brought together in His love and purpose for us. Today, let's read the Great Commission to affirm the purpose and calling that we all share. Jesus came and told His disciples, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age."
God is faithful.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Good morning and Merry Christmas, or Happy New Year, or whatever you're supposed to say in between the two. I'm thankful to be with you this morning. I'm thankful that we have this opportunity to gather together, even though we're far apart. More than that, even though I'm thankful that today the presence of God is with each of us, and it joins us all together. If you're home watching in your PJs, the presence of God is with you. And here the presence of God is. And if you're on the way somewhere, the presence of God is there as well. And I'm so thankful for that. Something most of you don't know about me, and I'm sure next to none of you will care about, is that we have a lot of pets in our house. We've got cats and we've got dogs, but first, before any of those, we had fish. Yeah, we have this fish tank. Let me show you real quick. Yeah, there it is, our fish tank. You see, we've had this since pretty early in me and Rachel's marriage because we lived at first in this tiny little on-campus apartment. It was like 500, 550 square feet apartment. We even lived there when we had Jonah, and it was a really great time. So we lived in this place, and the only pets that were allowed in this whole place were things in aquariums. And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not much of a reptile guy. Like, lizards are okay. They're a little expensive, though. Lizards, yes. Snakes, absolutely not. Those are gross. I'm sorry. If you're a snake person, my bad. So we decided on fish. It was the one that we could all agree on. We've had this tank since we lived in Nashville, and it's come with us over to Memphis, and that big move, that was a fun time moving the tank, and we've had a lot of fish over the years. I learned pretty quickly that you shouldn't name them. I made that mistake early, and then my heart was broken, and so rest in peace, Smudge. But here's the deal. We've had a lot of fish. My favorite of all the fish, the kind of fish at least, is the dwarf gourami. It looks like this. They come in a lot of different colors. There's a neon blue and a sunset and all these different pretty fish. But the thing I like about them is that they're colorful. They're a decent size. They're kind of big, so they show up well in your tank. And they play nicely with others, which is really important when you have kids at the house and you don't want any trauma from the fish picking on each other, right? In recent years, our number of fish at our house has dropped significantly. We used to have a lot, and over the years, they've just kind of slowly gone the way of the porcelain flush, if you get my drift. All right, and we've talked about it, and we decided, you know, me and Rachel talked, and we decided, you know, let's just not get any more fish. Let's not keep replacing fish as they go, as they get old. Let's just slow down. Let's take this off our plate. Let's let the tank empty out, and then we'll drain it, we'll put it away for a little bit. We'll take a break. You know, that was the plan. Here's the deal. The plans change, of course, and I didn't get a choice in this. Rachel's coworker asked her, you know, hey, would you go to the pet store with me? I want to get an aquarium. And I know you have one, so maybe you can help me look at fish. Maybe you can help me know what there is to see. And so they go to the pet store, and I hear about it. And Rachel, I called. I was like, hey, no animals, okay? No cats coming home this time. We were at capacity. We're at capacity with dogs. No. And she said, I think something about a ferret. And I told her, absolutely not. So they went. They looked. They had a fun time. Rachel was just like, oh, they had all these fish. It was awesome. And then a couple days later, they went to another pet store to see if they had better prices and better stuff, and they did. And that day, Rachel came home with four new members of the family, all right? So our fish tank started to fill back up. Over the last weeks and months, our fish tank has gotten very, very full. In fact, some of the last fish we added were my favorite fish, those dwarf gouramis, because my wife wanted to add just a couple more, but she didn't want to, you know, have me complain. So she bought my favorite fish, and it would totally worked. I was like, oh, sweet, some dwarf gouramis, that's great. And so we have this stocked fish tank at our house that I get to the joy of vacuuming gravel, changing filters. It's a blast, guys. I tell you that, though, to tell you this story. Last week while we were waking up to come to church, Rachel was up and moving, and I was still in that kind of, I didn't want to get out of bed, right? I had one eye open, kind of looking at my phone, and that was about it. When I heard from the front room, Ian, and tone matters, okay? And I knew from this tone, it wasn't like a dire emergency, but I needed to get out there. And so I quickly threw on my glasses, and I stumbled out to the front room, and I said, oh, what's going on? And she's pointing at our fish tank. I looked at the fish tank, and I'm looking to see, I figured probably one of the fish died. Like I said, I don't name them because I don't want to get attached emotionally, right? And so I'm looking for to see if there's a fish that had died that I need to take care of before we leave for church, or if something's wrong with the tank, if it's leaking. But everything looks good. Everything looks just like it's supposed to. So I look at her with this look of confusion on my face, and she looks at me with a big smile on her face and says, babies. Babies. I'm going, what? So I take a second, and I lean in close, and I look at this little speck of something I took to be just debris waiting to get sucked up by the filter. And sure enough, it's like a little itty-bitty miniature tadpole. I don't even know what this fish is because it's so small, I can't see what kind of fish it is. It seems like one of our fish at the pet store was a buy one, get a bunch of babies free kind of cost. I don't know. I guess that's a deal, right? Well, here's the deal. We went to church, after church, we went to the pet store and we bought this little nursery that sits in the tank, and it keeps all the baby fish, they float up atop, and so it keeps them all in their own little area so they're safe. You can feed them without them having to worry about other fish. And so we got home, we planted some more plants for them to hide in, but we also tried to catch as many as we could and put in this little nursery. So if you were there, you probably would have gotten a good laugh because you'd see me, you know, standing up trying to reach all the way down to this deep tank with a big plastic clear cup, trying to chase these little baby. They're this big, but they are fast little guys, I'll tell you what. And so I'm trying my best. I caught 7 or 8 of them, and eventually I started to notice my little gourami, my favorite fish, was following my hand all around the tank, right? It might seem sweet, but what I realized is the gouramis had realized what I was doing, and so when I would go and try to catch a fish, a little baby fish, the gouramis would come, and they were just being big helpers, I'm sure. If I missed, or even if I wasn't quick enough to get to them, those gouramis would run up there and take them and eat them in one bite. Yeah, it was a little gross. I'm sitting there, my wife is at the glass going, no! And I'm trying my best to scoop up all the little babies and get them in safety. And so after a little bit, the gouramis, I finally said, hey, we're done. I just feel like I'm just feeding gouramis at this point. And we saved as many as we could. And we still have a bunch of them. They're still doing well. Don't be worried. But the thing about it is it changed the way I saw my previous, still my favorite fish, those dwarf gouramis. You see, I can't just look at them and be like, you guys are so pretty. No, I look at them and go, you're a bit diabolical, all right? Eating a baby will do that to you. They traumatized my wife. She's probably going to have therapy after that. We just can't look at them quite the same as we used to. Some things happen like that where it changes the way we see the world, you know? It's true on the small scale about stupid stuff like baby fish and gouramis, but it's also true on the big scale with world-changing events. I listened to a researcher talk about the difference between generation X, Y, and Z, and they're talking about all these different things about them, and it was a really cool talk. But one of the things they were talking about was the thing that separates Y and Z was their memory of the event of September 11th attacks. They talked about how if you could remember it, you were probably in the Y camp and the way they delegated it. And if you couldn't, you were probably in the Z camp. And so they were talking about how the memory of the event and the attack affected this group, and how living under the shadow of it always being part of your history affected this group. It was fascinating. But this event came and it changed the way that we thought and the way we saw the world. It's not all big things and it's not all bad things either. I think about when I started dating my wife. When I started dating my wife, I was very sure to change the way I talked to girls. Because if I kept talking to girls the way I did before I was dating my wife, I was afraid she would think I was a flirt and she would leave me. And I was trying to date a girl that was way out of my league, right? And so I didn't want to give her any reason. So I very intentionally didn't flirt. I didn't, you know, I was trying to make sure it was very above board everything because I valued her, because the way I saw her, it changed the way I saw everything else. Having a baby, I'm sure if you're a parent, you know that's a game changer, right? Instead of rushing out for lunch, you're rushing out for diapers or going home and just desperately trying to take a nap, right? I remember having a daughter, and I was just terrified whenever our baby girl came, and I'll be honest with you, guys, I wasn't always sure I wanted a girl. I was scared about that because in my house, we grew up with brothers, and so having a baby girl was like, what do you do with one of these, right? And so it was a scary thing to think about having a baby girl. And that now both my kids are such blessings from God. I look back at the world that before I had these kids, before I was married to my wife, and I think, how did I feel complete? How did I feel whole when I was missing such a huge part of who I am now? They've changed so much about who I am, about how I see the world, about how I act. As we prepare for a new year, 2021, we say goodbye to 2020. Thank goodness, by the way, right? But as we prepare to step into a new year, it's natural to look back on what was and to look ahead to what will be. And I have to say, if I had to venture a guess, I would guess that this year, as we look back on what has been, it's probably easier than some years to put a finger on some changes that have taken place. Perhaps this year has made you more anxious or more unsure of your world or your place in it. Maybe it's thrown your finances out of a whack, or it's taken things away like proms, graduations, large family gatherings, or God forbid, family members or loved ones. This year's had a lot of change. I hope it's also brought great good as well. I know our family has had some highs along the way. I hope it's made us slow down and step out of the rat race and the to-do list for a moment and really value the blessings, big and small, to not take things for granted. 2020 is going to leave its mark on us for sure. I don't know how you go through a year like the one we've just had without having a mark left on you. As Christians, though, I hope that 2020 is not the biggest thing that's changing us and shaping us in this Christmas season. Because after all, last week we just celebrated Christmas. Beyond the new toys, the piles of boxes, and all the ripped up wrapping paper, beyond the Christmas lights and decorations and favorite songs and social gatherings we got to be a part of and the things we missed out on this year, beyond all of that, at its core, Christmas is the celebration that Christ has come, that God is with us, that God is here in flesh. Emmanuel, God with us. That's an earth-shattering change, isn't it? Sure, the events of 2020 will be talked about for years to come, but the events of Christmas? Those have been changing our world for thousands and thousands of years now. The events of Christmas are going to echo throughout the very reaches of eternity. Jesus' appearance shook things up from the very beginning. Think about it. The biggest birthday party in all of history, human history, and who's the invite list? A bunch of shepherds out in a field, a bunch of nobodies, for all sakes, intents and purposes. The most important party in the world, and these shepherds are the ones that see the angels break out in a hallelujah chorus. The whole thing, in a manger, in Bethlehem of all places, it's not quite what you'd expect, is it? And world-changing doesn't even begin to do it justice. But the thing about it is, that day, the presence of God was made real in a new way, and the presence of God changes everything. To be in the very vicinity of Jesus is to welcome change, to embrace change, because think about it, the lady that needed healing, that reached out just as far as she could and snuck up on and touched the hem of his robe, and by that small touch, she was healed. Think about all the people that had the joy of hearing Jesus preach and their lives were changed, or on the other hand, the rulers that all of a sudden who were sure of the rule, and then Jesus comes along and starts shaking things up to the point where they feel like they need to hang him on a cross to keep him quiet. Perhaps the greatest example of this of all is his disciples. Think about Peter. Oh, I do love Peter and all of his relatableness. He's also a bit of a loudmouth. I've been accused of that a time or two. And like me, sometimes he doesn't always say the right thing. Peter, who was humble fisherman, a person that most people would have considered forgettable or inconsequential in his day until Jesus showed up. And when Jesus shows up, he becomes the rock. No, not that rock. The rock that God used to build his church on. While Dwayne the Rock Johnson is pretty impressive in a lot of ways, there's no comparison to the amount of splash that these two rocks have made. Peter the rock that Christ built his church upon changed the very world by what God was doing through him. Peter's life itself was changed forever by that day when Jesus arrived, by the time he spent in the presence of God. He would never be the same because of what he saw and who he spent time with. Jesus just does that though, doesn't he? He shakes things up. In his first days on earth, his ministry, the cross, the resurrection, Jesus came and changed things. And as we celebrate Christmas and reaffirm our belief that God has come and that God will come again, we embrace the fact that he's going to change us too. Today I want to share a story of the presence of Christ changing things. In this case, it's about some disciples who were changed. I think this story speaks to us today about the transformational power of the presence of God. Take some time to let the word of God speak. I'm hoping that it challenges all of us on the eve of a new year. As we jump in, we'll be jumping into Acts 4, and allow me just to set the stage for us. This is right after Peter and John have taken the time to stop and meet a lame man on the Gate Beautiful on their way to the temple. And they healed him, and the beggar reaches out, and they said instead, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." And he grabs his hand and pulls him up, and the lame man walks. You'd imagine that the man that everybody knew is the person that begs at the gate walking would cause a little bit of a stir, and it does. And that's where we jump into the story today at Acts chapter 4. Please join me in the word of the Lord. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, they were confronted by the priest, the captain of the temple guard, and some of the Sadducees. These leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people that through Jesus there was resurrection from the dead. They arrested them, and since it was already evening, they put them in jail until morning. But many of the people who heard their message believed it. So the number of men who believed now totaled 5,000. Our story is just beginning, but allow me just for a moment to pause the story. Because what I love is, as these disciples move through the streets of Jerusalem, they're changing things just by their very presence, just like their Savior did. You see, it's not so much their presence, but as much as the presence of the God that they carry with them wherever they go. You see, these men had walked with Jesus. These men were filled up with the Holy Spirit. And in chapter 3, when the lame man reaches forward and takes the hand of Peter, it's not the presence of Peter that reaches out in healing. No, it's the very Holy Spirit, the power of God inside of Peter that reaches out. The name of Jesus, the presence of Jesus by which this man is healed. And so it is that a trip to the temple for prayer turns into this event that blows up a town. There's two important things here I want to point out real quick. And the first one is this. The leaders that we just read about, they thought they'd already dealt with this Jesus thing. They thought that was done. It was rearview mirror. But the thing is this, the power of God lived in his presence is far beyond what we give it credit for. The power of men would have fallen short when the crucifixion happened, but the power of God, far from falling short, it multiplied. Instead of Jesus as the focal point, now there are many hundreds walking around, these Christ-like disciples filled with the Holy Spirit, moving as Jesus moved in faith, talking as Jesus talked boldly. These disciples that are bringing the presence of God with them wherever they go. Jesus was and is he's God with us. But he left not just himself, he left the messenger, the third part of the Holy Trinity, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who puts the presence of God not in a manger for us to adore, but in our hearts for us to grow deeply into. What I love is that Jesus didn't come in these disciples' lives to change where they went once they died, but he came to change the way they lived. And for us as well, it's for us to live in the permanent presence and pursuit of God. Once the Holy Spirit filled Peter up, He goes from the man who denied Christ in front of anyone who asked him to the man who would boldly declare what God has done to everyone who would listen. Do you get that change? Anybody who asked that night, no, I don't know him. Everyone who would dare listen, he spoke about what God had done and what he is moving, how way he's moved in his life. The presence of God changed Peter. In John 17, 8 through 18, it says this: make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. And we see that playing out right here in Peter. He's being sent out to be as Jesus was, to live holy as Jesus was holy. Because to stand in the presence of God always leaves its mark on our lives. This Advent season, we lit 4 candles representing peace, love, joy, and hope. And it's with his presence, with God's presence, that we find peace in all circumstances. It's with his presence that we find love for all people. It's with his presence that we find joy in all times. And it's with his presence that we find a hope that cannot be extinguished no matter what. There's so much power in the presence of God. And unfortunately, these leaders took that for granted. And sometimes we can too. That power in the presence of God does not return void. That's the other thing from this I want to point out. What's amazing is while the disciples are thrown in jail that day, the words they preached, presence they showed of a God who moved in big ways, it didn't stop. 5,000 were saved. It's amazing when you think about it. In chapter 1 of this book, it talks about 120. In chapter 3, it talks about 3,000 coming to Christ on Pentecost, which is amazing enough in itself. And whether this is a new 5,000 or just another 2,000 on the old 3,000, God was moving in incredible ways. His presence, the presence of the Holy Spirit, changed everything. And what it tells me is that when we are faithful, God's presence and his power are more than sufficient for what we'll face. More than sufficient for what we'll face. And it's time for us as the church to live in the sufficient power and presence of who God is. The next day, the council of rulers and elders and teachers of religious law met in Jerusalem, and Annas the high priest was there along with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other relatives of the high priest. They brought in 2 disciples and demanded, "By what power or in whose name have you done this?" Can you imagine the room that day? They're standing here talking about this amazing thing that has occurred, and all around John and Peter is this huge, huge group of 71 people, 70 very, very powerful people in the area, and high priest, and it's probably a bit intimidating, right? Have you been on a job interview where you have a bunch of people on one side of the room and then you just kind of looking at you? It's awkward, I can tell you. What's crazy is that the people on the other side of the table have all the power, and that was absolutely the case here, is that these priests, these high priests, these religious leaders had all the power. This was the group that had met to condemn Jesus to death. And here, John and Peter are standing before them. And the other thing is, they weren't going to get a lot of favorable looks. You know, they weren't going to get that attaboy or a thumb up for anybody. You see, they were arrested because they were preaching about the resurrection. And the Sadducees, they just did not believe in that. They didn't believe in the resurrection and spirits and angels. They didn't believe in anything beyond what the here and now, what they could see. Does that sound familiar to anybody? I know a lot of people like that. These Sadducees were in power, and they did not like this message of the resurrection of Jesus to challenge what they had built, to hear people teaching differently from what they thought the way the world worked. What would it be like for you to stand before that group? Can you imagine the feelings you'd be feeling? When I was in college, there's a show that came out. You may have heard of it. It was called The Office. It was a little bit of a hit, so you may have seen it. But there's this one episode that makes me think of this moment. It's episodes where Michael Scott, regional manager of Dunder Mifflin, he's invited to a shareholder meeting because his branch is doing well. And so he wants to bring his entourage, and part of that entourage is Oscar, the office smart guy, the accountant, the guy who knows, you know, all the stuff they're supposed to know. And on the way there, Oscar's talking about if the company would do this, this, and this, you know, these idiots would do so much better at leading our company and make my stocks profitable and so much and so on. Well, they get there, and of course, Michael Scott is brought in just to so they can say, look at this good branch, despite the fact that the company is failing. And as Michael so often does, he starts making some bold promises and taking that attention. And when they recess to the thing, the board's mad at him, and he says, don't worry, I have a guy. He's got a plan. And he calls in his friend Oscar. And Oscar, the guy who was so confident in what he knew, and he knew all the right answers going forward, and when he's faced with this group of board members, of the CFO, of this congressman, it's just so awkward, guys, which is kind of what the show is about sometimes. And Oscar just buckles. He buckles. He just goes, oh, I'm sure you're much smarter than I am, and you're going to handle this so well, and let me get out of the way. And he bolts as quick as he can, possibly. Of course, Michael follows quickly after, so they don't lose their limo, and they take off, and it's played for laughs. But can you imagine the intimidation of John and Peter standing before this entire Sanhedrin, staring at the people that killed their Lord, knowing that these people have power over life and death in a large extent, and they're probably not a friendly group. I could understand if Peter and John were a little nervous, if nothing else. But instead, we find something very different. In verse 8, it says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of our people, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for a crippled man? Do you want to know how he was healed? Let me state clearly to all of you and to all people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, the man who you crucified, but who God raised from the dead. For Jesus is the one referred to in the scriptures where it says, the stone that the builders rejected, and he has now become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. Far from coming in and being overwhelmed, far from being meek, indifferent, or saving face, Peter goes in and swings for the fences, doesn't he? These guys are supposed to be on trial and on the defense, and Peter comes out respectful, but he's on offense. He says, are we being arraigned? Are we being put on trial because we did something right? In the Greek, it says an act of kindness. Are we in trouble because we did an act of kindness? As if that's not enough to kind of put the finger in the faces of the authorities and say, what are we doing here? He goes on to say, look, the man who's responsible for this healing is the man you crucified. I'm sure that did not get a good applause from the room, right? Can you imagine the looks they were giving of absolute astonishment, shock, anger, maybe even guilt? Because Peter said, there is no other name by which we are saved. No other name under heaven by which we must be saved. I imagine that must have been pretty shocking to them that day because, like many this day, there's a lot of things we look to be saved, a lot of things we look to in hopes that maybe it'll be the answer. And Peter standing there boldly in front of them declaring, this is the way. In verse 13, it says this, the members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. For they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. They also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing right out there among them, there's nothing the council could say. And so they ordered Peter and John out of the council chamber and conferred among themselves. The boldness of these guys just amazed the men standing before them. Far from being the ones overwhelmed, the disciples overwhelmed them. Because they were impressed and emboldened by their conviction in Christ. Empowered by the presence of God, they wowed a room of men that were not used to probably being wowed. And it wasn't their learning, it wasn't their abilities, it wasn't their natural gifts, it was the association with Christ that made all the difference. Jesus kind of saw this coming back in Mark 13:11. He told them, but when you're arrested and stand trial, don't worry in advance about what to say. Just say what God tells you to say at that time, for it's not you who will be speaking, but the Holy Spirit. The name of Jesus is power. The Holy Spirit is power, and it's power to work in and through us. In a commentary I read, it said that God had invaded human personalities, and he was releasing this power through their lives. And church, it's time for us to be bold, to not be like the religious leaders up in the stands, holding tight to the power they thought they had, but instead to cling ever so dearly to the presence of Christ to see where he's going to take us. If it's God's power working through his presence in you, the pressure's off us to perform. It's just our responsibility to be faithful, to say, God, here you go. You have the chance to succeed or you have the chance to fail. It's up to us to walk in faith, to live in a way that shows that we've been in the presence of the saving grace of Jesus, to know and walk in a way that shows the world that his power and presence is enough for us. The presence of God hasn't changed and it hasn't gone away. Going back to our scripture, it says, what should we do with these men? They asked each other. We can't deny that they've performed a miraculous sign. And everybody in Jerusalem knows about it. But to keep them from spreading their propaganda any further, we have to warn them not to speak to anyone on the Jesus name again. So they called the apostles back in and commanded them never again to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We can't stop telling about everything we have seen and heard. What a story. Well, what a two stories, really. On one hand, we have the disciples, outnumbered, but bold and courageous. We have the leaders, all their friends around, but they're unsure, without conviction. The disciples are confident in what they have to say, leaning on the truth. The leaders are digging in their heels and trying to protect themselves. The disciples are relying on God's power, and the leaders of the day are trying to hold on to their own power. Which one of those do we relate to more? Which one of those are we called to be? Man, I want to be like those disciples. Moved in a way that transforms me. Moved in a way that transforms those that come in contact with me. God, pour your presence on this place. The disciples holding fast to his presence changed everything. It's what caused the miraculous sign to take place. In the Greek, it talks about the miraculous sign was something that came to pass through them. It wasn't them. It was what God did through them. And since these high priests couldn't deny the miracle that had taken place because God had moved in such a big way, instead they tried to hide it, to limit it. And so the council threatened them further and finally let them go because they didn't know how to punish them without starting a riot. For everyone was praising God for this miraculous sign, for the healing of a man who had been lame for more than 40 years. And that ends the story on an incredibly hopeful note, and I hope it helps us in 2020 on an equally hopeful one. Because you know what? For 40 years, this man had been lame and broken and no more. 40 years doesn't seem like as long a time as it used to when I was younger, but 40 years is still a long time to live with anything. Think about how much effect a year of coronavirus has made on us, and think about 40 years of something. It would come to a point where we'd think it's beyond help, it's beyond hope. And yet, when the name of Jesus is spoken, when the power of the presence of the Holy Spirit is moving, the impossible is possible. The man stood up, he was made whole. When Peter talked earlier about saving, he was talking about being made whole. Just as there are no hopeless cases for God physically, there's no hopeless cases for him spiritually. It doesn't matter how far we're gone, how broken we are, physically, emotionally, spiritually, God's power, his presence is sufficient. The name of Jesus that enabled a crippled man to leap to his feet and walk, it's the same name that makes salvation possible for us. In Romans 8:11, it says this, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. The Spirit of God changes everything. It's why the church can move forward in hardship and outright persecution in triumph. It's why Christians can talk about trials and tribulations as James 1 talks about and having joy in them. We as a church have a glorious tradition of moving ahead through adversity in the presence and power in the name of Jesus. And what better time than this? What better day than 2020? In our story, the disciples pointed to one miracle and said, here you go. No other name can we be saved. Do you see this? Do you see what God's doing? We have thousands of years of miracles, of stories, of the history of God moving to point to say, world, God's presence and power is on display. Come and see what our Lord can do. While governments have tried over and over again throughout history to accomplish some great utopia, some amazing movement through socialism, communism, or democracy, it's through the church, the early church that was empowered by the Holy Spirit, that they were able to move in such love and generosity that no one was without, that everybody had everything, that they all held everything in one accord. And I'm not calling anybody to a government, to a socialism, to communism, to even democracy. I'm calling us to abide deeply in the presence of God where the impossible is made possible. Where governments of all sorts fail, the church empowered and moved by the presence of the Holy Spirit can make a way. Where human hearts fall short, those filled with the Holy Spirit can make something beautiful. It's the difference we see so many times through the Bible. So many stories in the Bible, there's the story of God's presence with and then the story without. And we see it in Acts chapter 9. When Paul's on his way to persecute the Christians, Jesus shows up. in the midst of what he thinks his life is about, and the trajectory of his life is changed. And he says later, I consider everything else rubbish beyond the joy of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. So God's presence is changing our purposes and our priorities. Consider Moses, who tried to save one of his own people and utterly failed and ended up in exile. And then the presence of God shows up, and he leads the entire people of God out of slavery into freedom into the land that God had promised them. God's presence changes outcomes. Consider the disciples out in the wind and the waves and the storm and the ocean and thinking this is it for us. And then they cry out to Jesus, and the wind and the waves are still. God's presence changes the way we deal with fear and anxiety. That presence isn't from a bygone day. It's not a used up commodity. It's not old news. It's not overwhelmed by the trials of 2020 or overwhelmed by the possibilities and the unknown of 2021. And it's time. It's time, church, for us to move forward as those disciples move forward, to pray as they prayed in Acts 4, 29 and 30 in faith. Let me read this to you real quick. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders to the name of your holy servant, Jesus. Church, it's time for us to pray that we would have great boldness to speak, that God would stretch out his hand in and through us to move in amazing ways, and that wonders would be made known through the name of Jesus. Because the world needs the presence of God more than ever before, and we have the calling to go. Let's pray. God, thank you for your calling, for your presence that sustains, for your presence that shapes, for your presence that changes, for your presence that comforts. And Lord, I pray that today, as we head into a new year and we take stock of what has been and what will be, that Lord, we don't forget to take stock of who you are and what you've done in our life. The Lord, your presence will overwhelm us in a new way. The Lord, we'll learn to cling to it more tightly this year than we ever have in the past. And that Lord, by clinging to you, the miracles will be accomplished. Lord, move in and through us. Do more than we could hope, more than we could pray, and more than we can imagine. Thank you, Lord. We love you in your name, we pray. Amen. I spent some time with my grandma a couple weeks ago. She started talking about her testimony, about the story of her and my grandpa and how things were before they found Christ and how things changed dramatically afterwards. The presence of God has changed my family forever. And I pray that the presence of God changes our next year. I'll leave you with this as we pray for 2021. James 4:8a says, come close to God, and God will come close to you. Church, let's go seek him with all we've got.